So far, we've built up a healthy collection of NP-complete problems. But given that there are thousands of known NP-complete problems, we've only scratched the surface. In fact, we haven't even come close to Karp's mark of 21 problems from his 1972 paper. If you want to go on and extend the set of problems that you can prove to be NP-complete, you might consider reducing subset sum to the knapsack problem, where one has a fixed capacity for carrying stuff and wants to pack the largest value subset of items that will fit. Another classic problem is that of the traveling salesman. He has a list of cities that he wants to visit, and he wants to know the order that will minimize the distance that he has to travel. One can prove that this problem is NP-complete by first reducing vertex cover to the Hamiltonian cycle problem, which asks if there is a cycle in a graph that visits each vertex exactly once, and then Hamiltonian cycle to traveling salesman. Another classic problem is 3D matching. 2D matching can be thought of as the problem of making as many compatible couples as possible from a set of people. 3D matching extends this problem further by matching them with a home that they would enjoy living in together. And of course, there are many others. The point of this lesson, however, is not so that you can produce the needed chain of reductions for every problem known to be NP-complete. Rather, it is to give you a sense for what these arguments look like and how you might go about making such an argument for a problem that is of particular interest to you. The reductions we've given as examples are a fine start, but if you want to go further in understanding how to use complexity to understand real-world problems, take a look at the classic text by Gary and Johnson on computers and intractability. Even though it's from the same decade as the original Cook-Levin result and Karp's list of 21 NP-complete problems, it's still one of the best. As Lance says, a good computer scientist shouldn't leave home without it.
Now that you have a better understanding of the nature and scope of the P versus NP question, we'll return to a high level in the next lesson and ask questions like, what would happen if P were equal to NP? What good might we be able to do? And in a world where P is not equal to NP, what are the hopes for coping with the NP completeness of problems that we would really like to solve?